Wow, I just realized I didn't record the past 5 minutes of my conversation with the camera. So, yeah, let's start again. Alright, boys, hey, Yon. Hey, hope I'm in frame, because I don't have a vlogging camera, so I can't see the screen. Boys, hey, Yon. Hope you're alright. Today I'll be talking about the design process for my undergraduate final year project. Week 6 to 9. So I posted a video, the previous video, which is for week 1 to 5 of the design process. So I'll be sort of doing the same thing, telling you guys how the design evolved. And yeah, so if you haven't checked out the first video, go check it out. I didn't get to do as much as I planned to because I was in the middle of moving back to Malaysia from the UK. And you know, had to do all the COVID quarantine stuff and you know, jet lag and not giving excuses, but yeah. Okay, so let's get on with the video and yeah, hope you enjoy. Week 6, this week we wanted to add residential flats to the building. Now, it might seem a bit arbitrary to do that in a public building, but there are some arguments for that. Now, we're trying to design sustainable cities for the future, and this building will act as a catalyst or a symbol. Now, sustainable design is a huge topic, and I'll have to talk about it some other day, but the three main aspects are social, financial, and environmental sustainability. For example, if you reduce the distance between working, living, and recreation, you reduce the need for vehicles, and thereby reducing, you know, CO2 emissions. And yeah. Market Hall by MVRDB is a good precedent for this. I talked about it in the previous video. Now, you see these holes on the sides of the wall? They are the windows of the apartments. The building has a total floor area of 95,000 square meters, with 228 apartments and 1,200 below ground parking areas. And this building is pretty big and it sits right in the city center of Rotterdam. It also sits in front of a train station as well. These diagrams are taken from their website. You can see there's a variety of apartment units, additional retail areas located underground with the car parking. The access to the apartments are on the sides with 6 vertical cores that service 4 units each. This was a plan for week 6. We highlighted in yellow where the flats would be accessed. The red highlights the access to the basement parking and retail. For the flats, we were thinking of doing something similar to the capsule house in the Osaka Expo in 1970. The Nakagin Tower was also one of our precincts. We thought to test it out and hang them above the botanical gardens. We experimented with different shapes. The existing cotton mill is to the right, but it didn't work. It looked kind of weird, so the idea was discarded. However, we still wanted apartments above the botanical garden to fill up some space, so we developed it later on. This is a ground level view from one of the entrances. We have the market stalls on the ground floor, floating above water. A suspended pavilion in the middle for culinary workshops and laboratories. To the sides, we have the suspended aeroponic gardens. The greens that are grown are relatively small, so we're not sure if you're gonna see them at ground level. Also, they're painted white to keep the temperature stable in the tubes. We were thinking of having the middle pavilion white as well to keep the continuity. We made sure to keep some distance between them and the roof deck cafe seating. That's about a 12 meter gap in between. Anyways, this is a view from the roof deck. There's sort of a sci-fi vibe to this with the suspended elements. They look like spaceships from the Christopher Nolan films. Now, last week we talked about using this building as an energy generator for the neighborhood. Now we already have solar panels on the roof, and we were thinking of using piezoelectric technology on the facade to harvest wind energy. We talked about the giant moving turbine idea on the sides, on the walls, and how it didn't work out in the previous video. This time we looked into oscillating turbines. They're a little more discreet when moving, which is what we were after. Found out about this project called the VibroWind Piezoelectric Pads that was done by Professor Francis Moon and his students from Cornell University. The key part of the design is Dura-Act patch transducer, which is made of piezoelectric materials that generates electricity from kinetic movement. In this project, they attach cubes made of aluminum to the transducer that will catch the wind and bend the oscillators. I'll have this project linked in the description below so you can have a look at it yourself. Going back to the facade, I remember being at the Wool Expo 2019. 2010 in Shanghai, and there was this insane UK pavilion. It was like a box with full of needles. Turns out it was designed by Hedwig Studio. I thought they were needles at first glance, but it turned out to be acrylic rods, 60,000 of them, that were 7.5 meters long, that penetrate right into the interiors, bringing in light through the acrylic. At the inner tip of each rod are 250,000 seeds cast into the acrylic, representing the UK's involvement in an expansive seed storing project. The light sources in each rod illuminate not only the seeds inside the structure, but the tips of the hairs outside as well, covering the pavilion in tiny points of light that flay about in the wind. I looked into the structure and how it's detailed because I was interested in doing something like this. There's a timber box underneath all the madness, which the rods are attached to. Each acrylic rod is encased by two aluminum sleeves, the first adding structural support to the acrylic and the outer sleeves providing a connection to the wall. The three components are attached to one another with single pin set through the walls. The rod assembly slides through the holes that are in the outer and inner layer of plywood, held about a meter apart. So imagine this, this is the metal tube, and this is two layer plywood walls here, and the acrylic rods slide into them like this. So this provide the structural support and connect the rods and with the wall together. And yeah, so that's kind of how it works. I suppose I'll have the project linked in the description so you can have a look at it yourself. So the concept of Arafasad was a combination of the Vibro Pads project and the Seed Cathedral Pavilion. We'll have the rod supported as the same way, but not go all the way in into the interiors for insulation reasons. I really question the insulation properties for the pavilion because there's a lot of punctures in the wall. Our building will last for a long time, so we can't design it like a temporary pavilion. No disrespect to the design though, the seed pavilion is pretty good. We will then have the piezoelectric transducer placed in the rods. The gap between the boards will then contain all the wiring and electrical stuff. Behind that, a service corridor for maintenance. We thought of having a spherical element attached to ends made of lightweight material to catch the wind and bend the oscillators, imitating a cotton field since the building we are protecting was a cotton mill in the past. And here we have a concept view of the exterior. We'll keep the ground level glaze for visual engagement and the rest just solid piezo facade. Now moving on to week 7, we spent working on the apartment units. The initial design was a compact 3.5 by 5 meter capsule for one person, a kitchen, toilet, bedroom, everything that you need. We were designing for the future society in mind. Right now in our current society, people are less settled, particularly my generation, I believe. There are more access to, you know, information and, you know, globalization, the internet, travel, whatever. Household sizes are decreasing and people are looking more to rent rather than to buy a house. So we assumed that the dwelling units for the future would be more disposable, hence the small size. However, my tutor wasn't really buying the tiny living idea, so we had to, you know, develop it further. That's all we done for week 7, and now let's move on to week 8. This week we introduced 3 different layouts for the apartments and we increased the size of them as well. The first one is a single bedroom that measures 3.5 meters by 10 meters. The toilet is located by the entrance, and as you move along the unit you cross multiple thresholds, starting from the kitchen to the study, then living and bedroom at the end. Here's a view from the bedroom, and also you can see the light coming through the windows on the right. We have built-in storage in all the units to save space. So good. Now the second unit is a bit larger, 4.5 by 10 meters. There are 2 bedrooms in this one, located at the end of the corridor. Toilet by the entrance. The living and kitchen has a little more space. They're both visually connected as shown in this sketch. The third unit measures 5.5 by 10 meters and has 3 bedrooms which are located on the end for privacy. In the center, we have the living and kitchen merged as one single volume. If we take a section through the 2 smaller bedrooms, when the tables are pulled down, what's left is a void that connects both sides and bringing light through the window from the other side. Now we worked on the vertical access to the apartments. 4 concrete cores on the end access through the east and west facade. These cores would have an escape stairwell which is shared by the office area as well. There will also be two lifts and an enclosed fire-protected lobby for the firefighters, then a corridor on the sides to get to the apartments, and of course the residents can access the other parts of the building as well through the up-floor circulation. This section shows the design at that time with the addition of the apartment flats on the top corners. We were concerned about the structure at the time. It could be a combination of cantilevering from the sides and hanging it from the trusses. We also had to sort out this awkward space up here in between the apartment ceiling and the trusses. We were also concerned about how the apartments would hinder the spacious quality of the botanical garden volume. The West Limerick Children's Center in Ireland had polished aluminum panels on the top volume. It worked really well in blending the building with the surrounding landscape, so we thought we could emulate the effect. Here are some concept renders of the idea in action. You can see that it is sort of invisible and also helps to expand the space as well. Alright, so moving on to week 9. This week we worked on the master plan and we looked at a couple precedents to get some ideas. Now, one of the key issues that we wanted to address was rising sea levels, and also we wanted to deal with sustainable urban drainage systems as well. This is Hafen City, a waterfront development in Hamburg, and it's 5 meters above sea level. It's been designed to adapt to annual flooding where the waters rise high enough to cover the promenade. There's a secondary pathway for pedestrians at a height of 7.5 meters. The first floor of every building on the promenade is dedicated to retail outlets and exhibition spaces that are sealed off in times of flooding. There's another project called Waterplain Bentonplein. It's located in Rotterdam, which has a series of water squares that act as detention basins to relieve the sewage system. They also filter and treat the water here to prevent unpurified water from running directly into the river. When it's dry, it acts as a meeting place for the residents and also for recreational activities. This also reminds me of the Tongyecheon River in Seoul, South Korea. There's a very long motorway built on top of the existing river, and they restored it in 2008. Now it's a public space that stretches 6 kilometers long. It's a nice bit of landscape architecture and families go there to chill out. Now, I was there in 2016 with my parents and we walked the whole thing at night. Now, it was a pretty cool experience because, you know, the lights were like shimmering off the waters. So this is a master plan that we worked out. We split into a few different districts. To the west along the banks, we have the waterfront boardwalk. This is where the nightlife is. You know, bars, restaurants, live shows, art, and cultural buildings will line the promenade. The master plan development is elevated 7 meters above sea level, similar to Hafen City, and a lower promenade that's 5 meters above sea level. The vibe of this place would resemble Darling Harbour in Sydney, and also the Clark Quay in Singapore. We liked how the buildings lining the waterfront were designed in human scale. Village Park to the east, which have mixed-use blocks for essential shops, retail, restaurants, recreational spaces, mainly to address and connect the residential development to its north, south, and the other side of the Delmarnock. It would sort of resemble the Hillside Terrace by Fumihiko Maki. It's a mixed-use complex that began construction in 1967 and continued to grow for 30 years, progressing through 7 stages. Each block added provided new functions. The building that we've been working on is called the Ark. Judging from the scale, it's quite obvious that this is the main feature of the waterfront development. With the facade, we wanted it to have a similar vibe to the V&A Museum in Dundee, particularly the austerity. The reflection pool works really well in fortifying its presence, and I think it also helps stop people, you know, climbing up the steps. So this is the facade of the Ark at the moment. We removed the spherical shape and just went with simple steel rods that will encase the piezoelectric actuators. We didn't like the spheres at all. We worked on it a couple weeks, but it kind of looked contrived, so we just removed it. So yeah, that's the design at the moment. That concludes the video too. So yeah, I'll see you guys again in another video. I hope you guys enjoyed this one, and yeah, laters.